Whoever honors his father is gladdened by children, and when he prays, is heard.
Bearing with one another and forgiving.
When Herod is going to search for the child and destroy him. Well, today is the Feast of Holy Family, and it's fitting because yesterday we celebrated the Feast of Christmas, the feast that celebrates the reality that God became one with us, entered human life as a child, as a baby. And then it's natural for that baby to be born in a family. And what does that say? If his birth into humanity transformed all of human life, his birth into a family means that family life is a sacred reality. It allows us to perceive what we all know, that family is special. That in family we learn what it is to be a human being, how to relate. It's not in kindergarten that we learn everything we needed to know. It's in the context of family that we learn everything that we need to know. It's profoundly important that we reflect on that and think about that. You know, there's a wonderful line from a play, Into the Woods, and it goes something like this: be careful what you say, children will listen. They do not always obey, but they always listen. My grandmother used to say, little pitchers have big ears. But you know what it is, they pick everything up. You know, if you're using colorful language, for example, and you say, where did they get all that? When they say it on the bus to school, and you say, I guess I know where they got it. But it's a profound perspective, and you know, you look at this and you say, the first reading from Sirach is an interesting reading because it talks about how do we care for our parents when they get older. And it's something to think about. And there are two stories that I want to tell you. The first one refers to Sirach, and it's a kind of an interesting little story. And you've probably heard it before, but it's a good one. It comes from Thailand or India, that area of the world. But every culture seems to tell this story. It seems that there was a young boy in a family of three children who just imitated his father, did everything his father did. He walked the way his father walked. He talked the way his father talked. He did what his father did. He wanted to be so much like his father. And the father didn't really notice it much, but everybody else knew it. It seems that this family would always sit down around the table and they would eat. And then when they were done eating, the grandpa was given a place in the corner and he would eat what was left over, the scraps from dinner, in a broken wooden bowl. And the boy observed all this. So it seems that one day, when the father came back from work, he sees his son working on a piece of wood, and he's carving it. And he says to his son, what are you doing? And he says, well, I'm making a wooden bowl so that when you're old, like Grandpa is, you can sit on the corner alone and eat after everybody else has eaten. You can eat from this wooden bowl. And after that, what do you think the father did? Grandpa sat at table with everybody else and ate. There's a lot of truth to that, isn't there? I just buried my aunt a week and a half ago or so, and my aunt had taken care of her mother, my grandmother, all through her illness. And as she struggled with cancer, she cared for her and took care of her. My cousin, who's exactly my age, I tell her she's older than I am, but she isn't. She took care of my aunt till she died at 91, and she took care of her the last, maybe 10 years, just taking care of all her needs. I guess it really is true. If you want your kids to take care of you when you get old, take care of your parents. Profound perspective, isn't it? But there's something sacred in that, one generation caring for the next. That's the point. The other story, actually, I would never have discovered except for Barb. She was handing out homily hints. And she said, she gave me a little section from a book by, his name is Gerald Boyle. He's a Jesuit, and he wrote this little book. It's basically about how he dealt with gangs in Los Angeles. But it's a very interesting little story, and he has this little story section. And it's, I think Barbara wanted me to use it on Christmas, but I already had my Christmas homily. But the story really refers to the Colossians reading we just heard. And the Colossians reading is really about putting on kindness, humility, meekness, gentleness, bearing with one another. It's really saying this is how you live in community. This is how you are to live in family. You are to respect one another. You are to care for one another. You are to be kind for one another. You are to put on love as a garment. And you are to live that way. And in that context, you will know what it is to give praise to God. It's really what it's saying. Well, the little story that Barb gave me is about the song, O Holy Night. But I'll tell it this way. Seems that when Gerald Boyle, he was one of eight, was a young boy, his mother said to him, don't go in the attic. Of course, when a mother says that to her children, they practically sold tickets to go to the attic. And so they go up to the attic, and they're going, and as he walks through the attic, and you know what it's like in an unfinished attic, where there's some boards down and there are other boards that are not down, you have to be very careful. And as he was walking in the attic, he realized why his mother said, don't go in the attic, because you can fall through the ceiling. But they didn't fall through the ceiling. They found all kinds of treasures in the attic. And he found these old 78 RPM records, you know, the kind you may have somewhere in your house. They're thick, they're real old. And he brought it down and he looked at it. And as they looked at it, they saw that it said Kathleen Conway. Kathleen Conway, that was his mother's maiden name. It seems that she was an opera singer before she decided to get married and have eight kids. And so the kids would lay on their bellies and on their toy phonographs would play the song, O Holy Night. And they would play it over and over and over. And pretty soon they played the grooves off the record. And what he discovered, or what struck him, what the line that struck him was the line that the world lay in sin and error pining until he appeared and the soul felt its worth. Remember that line? And I thought to myself as he goes on to explain the whole sense that when you recognize and you see people, and you see Christ in people, and you see the holiness in people, and you see how sacred other people are, when you see their worth, then you give them the kind of care and tenderness they need. What he was really saying in this little story was it's not just a cute little story about children enamored of their mother's voice and an aspect of their mother that they never recognized. So what he's really saying is what he learned in his family context was that people have value. He learned by the kindness he experienced in his own family that we are to be kind. He learned that the respect that he had experienced in his context of his family, that he had to be kind and gentle and caring for others. He learned the truth of the incarnation. And that's really the point of this feast. That Christ came, become one with us, that we can perceive that all is grace, that God is present in the core of life, and that we are to teach each other that vision, that appearance, that recognition, that without it, we are lost. We do kind of stumble in the dark, and we sit in sin, in error, pining, struggling for some meaning. But because of that vision of Christ, because of that sacredness of God's presence, because family is truly a sacred crucible of life, we can recognize each other's worth and give praise to our Heavenly Father. Something to think about, isn't it? I think both stories tell us a lot about what it means to live in the context of family. It's an opportunity for us to meet Christ in our relationships, in our dwelling with each other, in the way we teach our children, and the way we treat those who are elderly. It's in the way we live the whole rhythm of life. It's a great feast, isn't it? Because it brings home to us the meaning of the incarnation. It isn't just a nice feast. It isn't just a great celebration. It isn't even just where we talk about caring for one another. It's that we recognize that in our relationships with each other, in family, we recognize that we are a family of humankind, that all of us must relate in a new way because he appeared. And we can see one another's worth because in each other we see the presence of the Lord. Now that is something to celebrate.